amazing, God, the things we've seen as a church family over the years. We pray that you continue to do those things here. And we pray that, God, you would help us continue to see this church the way you do.
All right, how's it going, everybody? My name is Adam.
And my name is Tara. Welcome to RCC at Home.
Yes, the first ever RCC at Home, which is a produced service for you tuning in at home. But there's a couple different ways you can watch it. If you're not watching RCC at Home, you can watch RCC Live, which is a live stream of our actual service. But it's not going to be played anytime except during the service at 9 a.m. Yep, on Sunday. Or you could come in person. If you were practicing social distancing here, we're only allowing a maximum of 100 people in the sanctuary, so you have to register online and you can go to Ripon Church to do that as well.
But here you are at RCC Home, RCC at Home, and we are so glad you're here because we are starting a brand new series today called Masks. And as I'm sure you are well aware, we are all wearing masks out in the public these days, but that's not exactly what we're talking about in this series. We're talking a little bit more about the metaphorical masks that we sometimes wear.
Absolutely. Pastor Sam is going to be kicking that off, and we're starting something new called the Live It Challenge this week, and that is going to be just a way to enrich the weekend service. It's going to be released on Monday in video form. And you can check that out at ribbonchurch.com. It's got some questions and some highlights and some different things to go along with the message.
Good stuff.
So with that, let's get on with it.
Happy Sunday.
Ooh, ooh, I can see the clouds floating. I can feel the winds that try to shake me. I will not be moved by fear of the rock.
Break. I will cling to your unchanging grace. Hey, RCC family, my name is Sam. I'm one of the pastors here, and you are tuning in to our very first RCC at Home. We are so excited to bring this option to you for ways that you can participate in the services here at RCC, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So with that, welcome, whether you're watching on Sunday or Monday or whenever. We're so glad that you're with us and able to tune in. Now, as we're starting out this week, we're actually beginning a brand new series, and we're calling it, you guessed it, masks. We're calling it masks, and it's so crazy because masks are everywhere now. There's something that we've literally grown to know so well in the year 2020, these mask things, right? But the reality is we have been wearing masks long before 2020. We've been wearing them for a very long time. And these masks, they do a lot of different things. They hide and they cover. They protect us, and we hope that they protect us from the virus and those kinds of things. That's really important. And then there's multiple different kinds of masks. They can be this barrier, a barrier physically, but also a barrier emotionally. And they can even be these invisible masks that we wear that separate us from other people. Sometimes these masks, they're what we want other people to see. Other times these masks, they're just simply hiding what we really don't want people to see. But the most important point here is this, masks are not who we really are. That's just not who we are. Every week as we go into the series of masks, we're going to be addressing a different mask, and we're going to be looking at the ways that the Bible would address it for us and how the Bible looks at it. This week, we're going to talk about a little mask I like to call the let's pretend mask. The, you know, we're doing just fine mask. The let's just not show what's underneath this thing because we're not really sure that anybody's going to like what they find underneath mask. And this mask, it actually brings with it a number of different assumptions. The first assumption that it brings with it is this. What others see on the outside matters more than what's on the inside. Now, we sometimes think this, right? We assume that what matters in life is what other people see, what other people think about us. And so when we have this mask on, we assume that that's more important than what we're feeling on the inside or what we're experiencing on the inside. The second assumption is this. What's on the inside, underneath the mask, must remain hidden or our fears will be realized. We have this idea that if we don't cover up that thing that we've been holding on to and experiencing and feeling and it's been gnawing at us, if we don't cover that thing up, then our worst fears will be realized, will be exposed. And that is one of the biggest fears so many of us have, to be exposed. So we assume that this mask has to stay on. And the last thing is this, the last assumption we bring to wearing this mask is this. Perceived achievement and status are where satisfaction is found. We all want to look successful. We want to appear to have it all together. And that is one of the biggest reasons we wear these masks day in and day out. Now, do you know what wearing this mask really feels like? Do you know what it is, how it experiences, how we experience it as a person? It's kind of like this Coke can, right? Got a nice can of soda. I like Coca-Cola. I don't know what you do, if you're like a Mountain Dew person, a 7-Up person, like Mike talked about last week. But you got a Coke can, right? And this is us. The can is who we are. But inside of it is this bubbly, fizzy thing that, if we shake it, gets a little crazy inside, right? Like, this is an exciting thing. Like, this is what's happening all the time. And there's these things that just want to get out. And if we shake it enough and we just hold on to it and we just keep on doing this thing and we just decide, you know, we're going to... No, I'm not going to do that. But that's how it feels, isn't it? We feel like we're going to just let it all out. We're going to crack it open. And so often we feel like we just can't let any little crack in. Otherwise, there's going to be an explosion. When we wear this mask, we deny ourselves in such a big way the freedom God wants for us. We live constrained, stuck in this shell of a self that's holding everything in. We don't have the freedom that God wants for us. In addition to that, because we're living in such a constrained way, we also deny the world of our courageous selves. We deny the world of this person that God has called us to be, courageous and bold and brave, to live for Jesus. We can be people who live free, people who live with courage. This is what God wants for us. That's who we can be. But we can't be this person when we have the mask on. We can't. So the question this morning is, How do we live free? How can we experience this freedom? Because God calls us to be free, and not like Bill of Rights free or Land of the Free kind of free. Those are good freedoms. Those are great freedoms. But the kind of free I'm talking about is bigger and more important than that. It's the kind of freedom that only God can offer us. The kind of freedom that only God can make it happen in our lives. The God kind of free. Let me show you what I mean. There's this time, Jesus, He is traveling through Samaria, and as he gets into Samaria, he's going to be going through there, going to a different place. He sits out at a well in the middle of the day. His disciples head into town, and they spend some time in there doing a couple of things, getting some supplies. And so Jesus sits out by the well, and this woman walks out to the well to get some water. And as she approaches, Jesus asks this woman, who happens to be a Samaritan, if she could get him a glass of water. And she looks at Jesus and she's like, me? You want me to get you, a Jew, a glass of water? I'm a Samaritan. Are you serious? Like, you don't ask me for a glass of water. You don't like drink from the same glass as a Samaritan. That's just not what you do. And so Jesus laughs about it, I'm guessing. And he says, I'm sorry, but if you only knew, you wouldn't have me asking you for water. You would want to ask me for water because I give the kind of water that gives life. She didn't quite get it at all. And so she asked Jesus, she's like, hey, where's your bucket? Where's your rope? Because this well, it's mighty deep. Are you going to get water yourself in this way? And the woman, and Jesus responds, he says, well, you don't understand. The kind of water that you get right now, it lasts for a little while. It's something that you have to come back for regularly. But the kind of water I give, this life-giving water, it becomes a bubbling spring within you, and it never runs dry. The woman, she's obviously intrigued at this point. And so she says to Jesus, I want this water. This water sounds amazing. This is fantastic. Jesus responds, which is actually the culturally appropriate response during this time, because typically in that culture, you wouldn't talk to a woman without her husband present. So he asks her, where's your husband? Where's your husband? She says, I don't have one. I don't have one. And Jesus says, you're right. You've had five, and you're not even living with the man. You're not even married to the man you're living with now. The woman says, you must be a prophet because you're talking about so many things that how could you possibly know this? Well, then tell me, what's this whole deal with worship? Why do Jews worship in Jerusalem and my people say we should worship at this mountain? What's the deal with that? And so Jesus replied, it says this in John 4, it says, believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus told her, I am the Messiah. It's a crazy story, isn't it? But we get this picture of this woman, and we can tell she was not living free. I mean, she showed up at the well, likely at a different time of day, in the middle of the day, hiding from the other women who would come early, who would typically come early in the morning to avoid the heat of the day, and who would come together to stay safe. But she comes by herself, afraid of what they might be saying about her. She was ashamed of her past, so she doesn't open up very easily about it to Jesus. Jesus has to broach the subject. She strikes this defensive tone, this nervousness with Jesus, worried about what this guy, I mean, she's had some experience with some guys. She's wondering what this guy is going to do to her next. She wore the let's pretend I'm just fine mask. I've got it all taken care of. Don't worry about me. But she was anything but fine. And she was definitely not free. And yet Jesus saw her. Like deep down saw her to the point where she no longer had to hide. He gave her this gift of being known and in that moment not judged. Known but not judged. It literally takes this mask, this invisible mask right off of her. It sets her free, and in that moment when she realizes who this person is, that maybe he is the Messiah, it sets her free to a point where she runs into a village where she's ashamed and hides from all the people there and says this in John 4. It says, "Come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Messiah?" Jesus, he came to set us free. Free from every ugly part of ourselves, free from the shame, free from these feelings that we so often have of inadequacy, from the judgment, from the sin that is in our lives. We are called to be free, and it's all over the Bible. We're called to live these lives free from shame, free from the mistakes that we've made, free from these sins that just eat us at us and gnaw at us. I mean, it's all over the Bible. Look at Romans. It's in chapter 6, 14. It says, "Sin is no longer your master, for you no longer live under the requirements of the law. Instead, you live under the freedom of God's grace." When we believe in and trust in Jesus, when we call him Lord and we call him leader of our lives, he sets us free. So often, when we experience that freedom, when we're set free by Jesus, what happens is not that long later, we go running back to those things that once enslaved us. In Galatians, Paul writes this, he says, "So Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law." Don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. How do you stay free? How do you stay free? There's this reality to sin. There's this reality to the stuff that kind of gnaws at us that we feel like we can't get off of our chest, that just weigh on us. If we don't let it out, it just sits there. It just haunts us. The only way to get out of it is to be transparent. It's to tell the truth. It's to be honest. It's this crazy word that maybe we're scared of, but it's the word that really sets us free. It's confessing. In James 5:16, it says this, "Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results." Healed. How many times have you experienced this time when you've gotten that thing off of your chest and you felt so much relief? You felt free, healed. And I don't mean to blab to everyone about every little thing that you've ever done. I'm not talking about doing that sort of thing. I mean to those who you've offended, to those who maybe you hold dear, and most importantly, to God, to be honest with those people, to confess and be transparent and be vulnerable. These are actually the things that set us free. That is what creates freedom in our lives. That's how we feel it and experience it. And if you've ever had that moment where you've gotten yourself something off of your chest, you know what I'm talking about. It is freeing. You feel so light and so good. It's not popular to talk about sin. Like, that's an uncomfortable thing to talk about. But if we don't talk about it, if we don't talk about these things that eat at us, then it's never going to get any better. It's never going to get off of our chest. We're never going to live free. We'd rather, instead of talking about sin, we'd rather talk about God's plan for our lives. We'd rather talk about having really great community and awesome friends, or even maybe even how to serve other people who are less fortunate than ourselves. These are great things. These are amazing things. But they're also, at times, great ways to avoid dealing with this sin thing that keeps us from actually fully doing those things we just talked about. If we got this stuff on our chest that just weighs us down, it can really hold us back. It can keep us from living it well. We have this stuff that builds up this mask that is this invisible mask that covers us, that forces us to pretend. Sometimes it could be frustrations that we have that we don't want to get out. It could be things that we've done that we don't want other people to know about, things that we just want to hide. It could be stuff that we've done that we know we shouldn't do. It could be gossip, right? Golly goodness gracious, my word. We gossip. That's the thing we like to do. We're greedy. We're wanting more than we need to at an insane extent. We're judgmental. And honestly, right now, plenty of us aren't really necessarily thinking about our own stuff. We're having all kinds of thoughts in our head, thinking about all the people like next to us, or the friends we have, or our spouse, or maybe our enemies, and those people we're frustrated with, and the sin that they've got to deal with in their life right now, which proves the point. We've got our stuff. We've got our things that eat at us, and sin, it's this thing that produces this barrier between us and God and us and other people. This is real life, and whether you like it or not, you need to know that the only way to live free, the only way to experience the fullest freedom that God offers, the only way to actually rip off this let's pretend mask is through honesty. It's telling the truth. It's being vulnerable. It's this word of confessing. When you confess to God, who, by the way, knows all of your junk anyway, so why keep it from him? Why try and hide it from him? Just get it there. He knows it. So talk to him about it, or to your spouse, or to close friends, or maybe someone you think you might have offended. When you do that, when you get it off of your chest, this thing that's been weighing you down, you are set free. Those things we try to hide and stuff down, they begin to lose their power. Now, why is this so important? Why does this matter so much? Because you can't live the kind of courageous life that God calls us to live when you're afraid to be bold because of what you feel like you have to hide. All that time trying to hide it wastes energy. It gnaws at you. It separates us from the forgiveness and freedom that Jesus offers us when we confess and choose to follow his way. Vulnerability and honesty and truth-telling and confession, they matter, and they get us to part two of this process. This process of first freedom, then courageous living. Living with boldness and with bravery. We need to take the let's pretend mask off if we're ever going to live with courage, if we're ever going to be brave and live the kind of life that lives up to God's call on our lives. There's this time that this richer young man, he comes up to Jesus, and he's experiencing this excitement about Jesus, right? He's heard all about him, so he comes to talk with him, and he says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Oh, why do you call me good? Only God is good," kind of alluding to something there. But he says, "Well, follow the commandments. Don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't lie, honor your father and mother, and don't cheat other people." And the young man, in a really earnest way, it seems, says, "Well, I have done these things since I was young." Look what it says next. It's in Mark chapter 10. It says, Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. "There's still one thing you haven't done," he told him. "Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." Jesus, he looks at him with genuine love. It's crazy. He says, he's basically saying, "Good job, guy. You're doing awesome, right? You've done things that you're supposed to do. Now, what you have to know next is you can't buy your way in. You can't purchase your way into eternity. You can't do enough. This grace thing, it's a gift. To accept it, you need to rely fully on it. You can't rely on your status or your image or your money or all these other things to try and keep in there. It's like a safety net. We're talking about this reality where you have to literally rely fully on me," Jesus says. And once Jesus says this, there's possibly one of the most heart-wrenching and heartbreaking lines in all of the Bible. This is what happens next in Mark 10:22. It says, "At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. The story, it gets me every time. It says Jesus looked at this man with genuine love. Genuine love. Can you imagine Jesus looking at you that way with genuine love? I wonder if Jesus entertained the thought of the brave and courageous man in that moment before he walked away and before he went away sad. I wonder if Jesus entertained this idea that maybe he's going to accept it. And like maybe Jesus and all his humanness, because he's God, right? So you'd imagine that he knows all the future things. But maybe in that moment, he as a fully human person as well, he had this moment of, what if he does it? What if he goes and sells the stuff and comes and follows me? And he saw this picture of this man's life transforming and changing, and the life lived for something bigger than himself, and how that could have become something, and just all the amazing gifts and the joy that man would have experienced having followed him. And I wonder if Jesus saw all of that. But it wasn't meant to be. His face fell. He chose status over meaning. He held on to the safety of what looked like success on the outside rather than jumping into the life that Jesus offered. You see, God calls us to be courageous, to live bold and brave lives according to God's calling, to live to love God and to love others. But we can't live that life when we're living hidden behind a facade. We can't live that life when we're fearful of being exposed or found out. Have you ever met someone who knows they're going to die? I mean, we all know we're going to die at some point, but have you ever met someone who knows, like someone who knows and it's coming soon? Have you witnessed how they hang on the words of the people they love? Have you witnessed how they don't waste time and yet they slow down for the conversations that really matter? Have you witnessed how they summon courage that they just never had ever before? Can you imagine it? Could you imagine it for yourself? Could you imagine it for your own life? Can you imagine the relationships that you'd want to make right? Can you imagine the things that just wouldn't matter anymore? And can you also imagine the things that really, really would? Can you imagine this real and raw and vulnerable and free and courageous life that you could live? Can you imagine that? I think you can. You can, and this is why the let's pretend mask is just so dangerous, because it steals our life right out from under us. It grows doubts that others don't want to really like or enjoy the person that we really are. It creates a shame and torment cycle. You hide to avoid the shame, you're trying to keep it away from you, and at the very same time, you're tormented by the fear that someone's going to find you out. It compounds the power of sin in our lives, making us slaves to the sin. It literally makes us so we are bound to it and held to it. It forces us to live lives as slaves, unable to truly be free. We don't experience the freedom that we were meant to experience. We rob the world, in addition, of the courageous life and the courageous person that God is calling us to be, because we have this mask on. It keeps us from everyone else. It doesn't need to be this way. You don't need to live behind that invisible mask. There is a way to be set free from our self-created prisons. We can live free and courageous lives by making and repeating these two decisions over and over again. The first is this: choose freedom. And it's the freedom that Jesus offers, this freedom that comes from a man who came to this earth who is fully God and fully human and lives this perfect life, giving us this image of what living for God's kingdom looks like. And then in addition to that, he goes to this cross, holding on himself, taking on himself every last bit of our mis our failings and our sins and the ugly stuff that keeps us from God and keeps us from others. This is what Jesus does. He takes that all on himself. And then when he does that, he goes on the cross, he goes into the grave, and then he rises us and gives us a picture of what's to happen to us, this eternity that we can look forward to, this kingdom of God that we can look to. We can be set free by trusting in him and saying, Jesus, you beat death. You're our Lord. You're our leader. We're going to follow you. We're going to not hold anything back. We're going to be honest and confess and be real and choose to follow you. That is where this freedom is found. That's the first step. And the second is equally important. It's to live courageously. It's to let go of the status and the facade and instead follow Jesus. Follow Jesus with our lives, to live as these disciples of him. How can you actually live this way? What if you could? What if it could be different? What if you were inspired on a Sunday, but you didn't just leave it in Sunday, you took it into Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and the rest of your week, and you were free and you lived courageously? Starting on Monday, I want to encourage you to do that. I'm going to help you do that. I want to help you take this from a Sunday excitement and put it into a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday real life change. And we're going to do that by having this thing called the Live It Challenge. Every Monday, we're going to release a short video that looks at how the sermon can impact your life this coming week. We'll give you a little bit of an expanding bit of scripture, and then also a few questions to consider, and then some challenges for actually how you can put this into practice in your life this week. You can actually go to ripponchurch.com and you can sign up for that. You can get on the email list so it's delivered to your inbox every Monday. Or in addition to that, you can hop on Facebook or on our YouTube page and you can see it there as well. But here's the thing. It's got to be more than just an idea. It has to be a life change. You can be free and you can live a courageous life. And if you want that for yourself, would you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for the fact that you set us free. Help us to take this let's pretend mask off. We admit that we've got our mistakes. Forgive us for those. We know you're ready and willing to do so. Set us free. And then God, help us to live for you, to live a courageous life, a bold and brave life as a disciple of you, doing the things that we should do to love others and care for others as your disciples and not so worried about our status or any other thing like that. We thank you for your kindness and your goodness and the meaningful and purposeful life you give to us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
So in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, it says that God loves a cheerful giver. And you need to know that when you give here at RCC, you're not only honoring God with your finances, but you're supporting the mission and ministries of this church. And there's a couple different ways you can give. You can give online. You can go to rccsunday.com. There's a giving platform on there that's super easy to use, super user-friendly. You just click on the icon and you can give using a credit card or a bank statement. You can set up a reoccurring gift or just do it once, one time. And another thing you can do is a lot of people like to give by giving a physical check in an envelope. If you want to do that to us, totally fine. Our address is 155 State Street. We have a little mail slot on one of the doors that you can put it in. It's the door that's on the lower level that faces State Street, Fond du Lac Street. And that's what you can do too. So love you guys. Can't wait to see you soon. Have a great week. See you next Sunday.